Okay, we're going to take a look at the Civil War Brigade series by The Gamers. Now, this series first began in 1995 with the first title, In Their Quiet Fields, The Battle of Antietam. They later did Thunder at the Crossroads, which covered the Battle of Gettysburg, and they did the other big ones like Murfreesboro, Shiloh. They then branched off into some of the smaller ones, like Champions Hill, Gaines Mill, Seven Pines, Malvern Hill. And the last title was in 2006, which covered the campaign on the North Anna. So it's been a popular series and has spanned quite a number of years in the hobby. I know the Civil War buffs praise the series very much. We're going to take a look at the titles that I have. I only have four of them. In Their Quiet Fields, Antietam, Thunder at the Crossroads, Gettysburg, Champions Hill, and the Three Battles of Manassas. We're just going to look at the maps, show you some of the counters, and we're going to look at some of the charts and study why this series is so popular. Okay, this is the redone title, In Their Quiet Fields 2, The Battle of Antietam. In the center here, you've got the town of Sharpsburg, and you can see Antietam Creek and the Potomac River here to the left. Now, the boards are quite colorful, and they are certainly functional. There's no argument as to whether that's high ground or low ground. Everything is clearly delineated. They're not maybe as graphically pleasing as some of the newer titles, but they are certainly functional. And on the edge of each map, they had all the relevant material to play the game. Each turn was approximately a half hour, and you've got your Confederate casualty chart here and artillery ammunition. The Union had the same, and your elevation guide to explain the map. Your terrain effects on movement was here, and you had a special track for, well, with any Antietam game, you probably got a McClellan rule, and this game was no different. So that's what the Antietam board looked like. Nice looking, I guess. Like I said, not as aesthetically pleasing as some of the newer maps, but certainly functional. Let's take a look at the map, or rather the counters. Okay, I've laid them out this way just to give you an idea of how many counters are in a core, and I'll lay them out in a second. The simulation level is brigade level, so each counter generally is a brigade, and the leaders, of course, are the leaders of the brigades, or corps in this case. So I'll lay them out and give you an idea of how they work. Okay, that's a typical layout, for example, the first corps, about, what, 17 counters or so, 18. And, of course, you got your leader hooker. These are your divisional leaders, Doubleday, Meade, and Ricketts, and the brigades attached to those division leaders. You've got corps artillery divided into three sections, so you could sort of look at these as kind of divisional artillery, since there's one artillery for each division, and then, of course, your corps supply. Now, the counters look harmless enough when you spread them out like this, but I can assure you, when you're in the confines of, let's say, the east or west woods or in the cornfield with the Confederates adjacent to you, it gets a little hard to see who's who, especially with informational markers on them. Let's take a look at Jackson's second corps for a comparison. Okay, and there's Jackson's corps laid out, some 29 units. Jackson's corps has four divisions, and Evans' separate brigade was attached to it. Again, you can see the corps artillery here, divided into three units and a supply unit. Each of the divisions is color-coded. You can see an orange symbol here for AP Hill, red for Jones, and yellow for DH Hill, and so on. So they're all, there's a mine of information on these counters, and we'll go through what each of the numbers mean. Same with the Union. Now, I'll spend some more time on the Antietam game showing you the counters, but we won't do that for every title, because all of the titles shared a common kind of look for the counters. Now, most of the information on the front of the counter are merely identifiers to the historical unit. So, for example, this JJ2 means Jackson's division of Jackson's Corps. And with the Union, it's the same kind of thing, showing you the 1st Division, 1st Brigade of the, what, 3rd, no, 1st Corps, 1st Division, 3rd Brigade. So this is just all information giving the historical. There's actually no game function on the front of any of the counters, except for the artillery. They show you generic strength points. The artillery are not named, which I thought was a little strange. If you're going to have a brigade level game, you might want to have the artillery at least in battalions, but they didn't go that way. They went with brigade level infantry and kind of generic artillery units, which is a bit of a shame. And the flip side of the artillery, of course, shows the unit limbered, and the front side shows the artillery unlimbered. Well, what does the back of the counter show? Let's take a look. Okay, well, look at these two Union counters, for example, when you flip them. Well, the flip side shows COL, means the units in column. That's fair enough. Again, re-identifying the brigade. And the little AA represents the fire factor that the brigade will fire on, and we'll get to that in a moment. So that's game information, and kind of that is game information. And the 1-2-1, again, is just historical identification. So I just find the counters, they're not utilizing the best uses of space, you might say. Why repeated information everywhere? And I find when you're playing the game, you're flipping these things back and forth all the time and adding markers. Now, why do they go that way? Well, they went that way because they went with a roster system. So most of the mine of information about the unit and its fire value is here on the rosters. So for example, Archer's division, well, his morale is A, and it'll, you know, it'll fire on level B. Branch's division, morale is B, and it will fire on the C table. And these little boxes, of course, you check off as the unit takes casualties. So there's a lot of bookkeeping for this game. That can be good and bad. It keeps the counter density low on the board, the informational markers, but you're constantly having to go back and forth to the rosters and the map to find out the fire values and how to fire. And we'll get to that when we look at the charts. So that's all I'm going to say about the counters. If you can live with just the historical designations and the information on the roster, that's fine. But I find, for example, a game like Antietam, when you get a lot of units in close proximity to each other, Union and Confederate, and I mean hundreds at the same time, it becomes very hard to tell who's who sometimes. There's a little bit too much color. I really wish they would go with the traditional, most of the gray counters are Confederate, and most of the blue counters are Union. They did not go that way, and that's just the nature of the beast. So that's the counters. Let's take a look at some of the charts. Okay, we'll take a look at the rules booklet first. The series rules, and this one is the second edition if you get the Antietam game, number 2, 1992. And the rules are about, what, we're talking 32 pages of rules, and there's a lot of rules. It's fine print, and this is not an easy game to learn. There's a whole host of charts, and I'll get to them in a moment. I mean tons of charts. Actually, we'll do a count on those later. So, yeah, over 30 pages of rules, very, very detailed rules. Civil War gamers being Civil War gamers, they want something detailed, and this system certainly serves. You've got a very rigid command structure, which you must obey, and we'll get to that in the brigade orders section. But so this is not a beginner's game by no means. If you're introducing somebody to the hobby, you certainly would want to begin with the brigade series. Now, along with the standard rules, you get a booklet too, which is the exclusive rules for Antietam. This is about 22 pages or so, and most of it is graphs and repeat graphs of the rosters. Not too many exclusive rules. The setup. Okay, I can say something about the setup here for Antietam. I don't know about the others in the series because I only have four, but Antietam is a nightmare setup. It really is bad. Why? Because you have to set up every single brigade in specific hexes. And, as we'll get to later once again, you have to put these extension markers on certain brigades that are in an extended line. It's a very laborious and slow process, especially when you're setting up a whole game. But if you're reading the Battle of Antietam and don't mind the setup time, this is probably your cup of tea. Now, Gettysburg was quite different, of course, being a three-day battle. But in Gettysburg, you only set up with, what, two units? Devin Gamble, and you throw up Heath and Davis, Heath's division. Davis and Brockenborough, throw them on the pike, and away you go. Four or five counters, and you started the game. But Antietam, or any set-piece battle, you're going to spend a lot of time setting up the game. That's just the nature of the beast. Okay, charts. You want charts? You got charts. Now, I've just counted them, and then depending on how you count, you might come up with a different number. But I come up with 21 different charts. Now, if we just name them, go through them, you'll see how detailed this game really is. Okay, a command point table, an order costs chart, an initiative table, your core stoppage attack table, your acceptance table for orders, the formation effects, morale state effects, stacking level here. We won't count the order log. The fire determination chart, artillery range, fire combat table. I won't even count the modifiers, which of there's the whole host. The straggler table, two different ones. And the beloved morale table for shaken units and disorganized units and bloodlust units and disorganized units and a whole host of modifiers. Close combat resolution and odds table. A gun loss table. Straggler recovery table. So that's just a bit of the tables that are in the game, a lot of them, which goes to show you how detailed a simulation this is. And I say in every sense of the word, simulation. Now, from my tone, you might get the impression that I don't like the series very much. And you wouldn't be very far from wrong. I have tried the series. I played out Gettysburg for a while. Did not finish the game. These are a huge investment of time. If you were to play a game of Antietam or something, you're gonna burn up a day at least to play a game like that. Gettysburg, I can't imagine. A couple of weekends. So this is a very detailed system on brigade combat in the Civil War. In fact, the series prides itself on that, saying that it's, in their opinion, the best, or maybe the fans say, it's the best Civil War brigade level game out there as a simulation. And you know what? I agree with them. I think it is one of the best simulations of Civil War brigade combat. The trouble is, for me, there isn't a lot of game in there. I found when I played Gettysburg and some of the others, the battles went so much like the real battle that there was nothing really to game. And it is a slow system. There's no way in the world you're going to play this game fast. But let's take a look at some of the other titles and the maps. Okay, we're taking a look there at Champions Hill, which is a battle in the Vicksburg campaign. And many of the veterans of this series recommend that if you're just starting the series, this might be the title to start with. And I think I agree with them. It's a much smaller battle. It's much more, straightforward, you might say. And there's not as many counters. So the roster sheet is, I think, a single sheet for Union. Yeah. And Confederates, yeah, much smaller too. And, of course, it's Grant versus Pemberton on the road to Vicksburg. Grant's men come this direction. Pemberton is along this Ratliff Road defending. I didn't say anything about the order system, and that's where the meat of this game is. That's where the game really shines, the order system. In this game, you're just not going to be able to move every counter wherever that devil you want. You've got to write orders for units, depending on the scale of the game. You have to write at the corps level or the division level. And in Manassas's case, 1st Manassas, you have to write at the brigade level. It's still got the time record about the same. Each turn is about a half hour, and the scale is about the same. Champions Hill has the same style of map as Antietam, the block kind of hexagons. the trees make it look better. Cosmetically, it's a nice map. The counters are the same as all the others. They look very much the same with the historical information on the front, very little information on the back, and a whole host of game counters, which I didn't show. I did also show the extended line counters. Maybe I should show you a close-up of that, and something I dislike very much in the game. Okay, this is a very crude example of what I'm talking about. For example, in Champion's Hill, they chose, of all colors, like gray for the Union, a dark gray, and light gray for the Confederates. I thought that was just a ridiculous design decision. Very hard to tell who's who when you get a bunch of these counters together. Now, I'm exaggerating here, or actually simplifying. You're only seeing like four counters in line. But I tell you, when you get a whole mess of these all together, it's very hard to tell who's who. The other thing I really object to is this extended line stuff. Because it's brigade level and they want to show different sizes of brigades, some brigades are larger than others, they want to show that the brigade could actually extend into an adjacent hex and therefore use these extended line markers. And when you get a bunch of these on the board with other brigades and stuff, it gets really, really messy. I far prefer the standard Civil War system where you might as well go to regimental anyway if you want to show battles on that level. But this is brigade level, and that's what they're trying to show. Now, I did not show, and will not show, how fire works in the game. You can see my Gettysburg video for that. Or if you want to see how the game plays, I'd recommend seeing Enrico Vigliano's series of games. He played a whole bunch of these out, and you can see how the game plays. So I'm not commenting much on gameplay here. Just overall, the look of them, and to show why they're popular. They're popular because it purports to be a very good simulation of brigade-level combat. And in the net result, they are. You are going to get historical results playing this game. But it's almost like watching a modern-day movie, a two-hour movie, and watching 30 seconds of the film and stopping it, then starting it up again, then watching another 30 seconds and stopping and starting up again. This game plays extremely slow. If you could see what you have to go through to do one single fire phase, you'd see what I mean. There's a lot of looking up, a lot of recording of damage, and placing of markers. And that's why I dislike the game. But let's take a look at some of the others in the series. Okay, we're looking at the Gettysburg map, looking northwest, and I can't even get it all in the frame to show you how big the game actually is. It's a two-map game. So we'll just zoom in on some areas that I know you're familiar with. The town of Gettysburg itself, out the Chambersburg Pike. There's the Oak Ridge, the old Cemetery Ridge. We'll go down the Emmitsburg Road, way to the edge where the Union troops come in, and the old Tawnytown Road, and up Rock Creek, Wolf Hill. So it is physically a big game. There's no way I finished this beginning to end, and there's no way I would. I did a video on it, doing the opening phases, the first day, where Devin and Gamble are opposing Heath's division. So if you're interested in a little bit of what that game is, I've got a video just on Gettysburg itself. There's no point showing you the counters. They're just the same as all the others, really. Same idea. Tons of information counters. I've sorted them here into their divisions and stuff. You better have a good sorting system for this game, too. Or it's going to take a heck of a long time to set it up if you play this July 2nd or July 3rd scenario. Of course, the gamers had to do Gettysburg. Just about every company that does Civil War games ends up doing a Gettysburg game. And as I found, that it is a good simulation of the Battle of Gettysburg. In fact, it's almost too good. The Gamer series, in my opinion, is almost a victim of its own success. They're such good simulations of the battle that they're almost boring to play. They're very, what I would say, predictable. I think when I did my game, we ended up having the fight near McPherson's woods, as they did historically. Units came up on time, and the battle was very, very historical. And, well, is that a bad thing? Well, no, not really. It's not. I mean, I like my games to be historical. But this one is so binding that there's not much game in it. I just found it was like watching a movie in slow motion. Anyway, that's Gettysburg. Quite a nice-looking game in the series, and quite rare now, because this one's been out of print for years. Okay, we'll take a look at the three battles of Manassas. Of course, there was only two in real life, but they give you a third hypothetical battle. Let's take a look at the map to this one, and it's also a big one. Okay, the three battles of Manassas map is actually three maps. I misspoke. It's huge. I've actually had to put the extension in to get all of the map in. So that's sort of section number three, section number two, and over on the right, section number one. So we'll go over it just briefly. This thing is just huge. You've got Centerville up here, and we'll follow Bull Run, which isn't very well delineated, I might add. We'll just follow it there. McLean's Ford, Blackburn's Ford. Many a game of Manassas I've seen that the whole game just fits on one board. But we go over here to the Matthews Hill, the Groveton Woods, the Henry House Hill, and then stretching way over here down the Warrenton Pike all the way to Gainesville. The reason they do this, of course, is because this game includes the Second Battle of Manassas, which really sort of began here and moved east. So this is a huge game with three sets of counters in it. The time scale is the standard one of a half hour, and your train effects chart and stuff are right on the map. I think it's the nicest looking of all the maps, though they still go with the solid colors for the hills. But their use of the terrain, the trees, I think is a little bit nicer than some of the other ones. So I think it's the nicest looking map of them all. Okay, let's do a summary of the system and make a general statement about the state of the hobby where it comes to Civil War games. Okay, the Gamer Series. Certainly, if you are a Civil War aficionado and you like the Civil War and you don't mind a detailed simulation of Civil War combat, this might very well be your cup of tea. But they are slow games to play. There's a lot of bookkeeping, and they don't move along. You can't play these in a couple of hours. You're just going to spend a lot of time playing them. But if that's what you want, good simulations, and at the expense of playability, this definitely is your cup of tea. Now, for me personally, I prefer the Great Battles of the American Civil War. But that series has its problems too. For one thing, it's mostly out of print, just like the Civil War Brigade series is. Most of these are out of print. And the early titles are, commanding high prices on the hobby market there. The Great Battle System, it's got its problems too. And you'll see that in some of the other videos I did on the system. It's still my favorite, but, frankly, it's buggered up too. In 17 volumes, they've changed the rules. Most of them are out of print. And this series is in a mess too. What we really need is a whole new series of Civil War games. And that's lacking in the hobby. What I'd really like to see, and I don't understand, is some of the games like this. Like the Revolutionary War series there by Mark Miklos, Guilford Courthouse, Germantown, Monmouth, Saratoga, Savannah. They're all battle games. They all have a common system. They're still in print, and Mark keeps coming up with new ones. So I can't understand why the Civil War, which is, America's national conflict, very popular, we have no real equivalent. We just have no equivalent games for the Civil War. So that's kind of the state of the hobby the way it is right now. We're not really seeing many Civil War games coming out as a series. And, if another Gettysburg game comes out, I think I'll scream. And they continue to come out. They keep doing Gettysburg over and over and over and over, and they still don't get it right. I really don't understand it. There's no reason why someone can't design a half-decent Civil War Brigade level game that can be played in 4 hours or less. It just makes no sense that that hasn't been done. But that it hasn't been done. If someone can recommend a Civil War battle game for me that can be played in 4 hours or less, I'd certainly like to hear about it. So that's kind of the summary of the way things are. I'll continue to do other Civil War videos on some of the others in this series, but state of the hobby is a bit of a mess when it comes to Civil War games. I don't understand why they're not as popular and why they're not being done. But the gamers, they did a good job. They had a good run, 1995 to 2006. The Chickamauga game was supposed to be reprinted by MMP, but I think they gave up the ghost too. So I think the gamers series is now at an end. So if you want to pick up some Civil War titles, maybe pick them up now while you can, because I don't think they're going to be around for much longer. Now, of the gamers series, I'm probably going to be getting rid of most of them. Which one am I going to keep? Well, one would think you're probably going to keep Gettysburg, right? No, actually I'm not. I'm going to keep, of all things, the Three Battles of Manassas. One, because you get two games in one box. And two, because of all things, I think the one that's actually playable in an afternoon is First Manassas, because it's brigade level. You write brigade orders, and the army commanders had to command individual brigades. And for that reason, I think I'll keep probably Manassas. I know Enrico mentions that if you play Manassas, it's unlike the others in the series, and he's quite right, because there's no corps orders in Manassas, because there are no corps. So Manassas, first battle, is quite different than the rest in the series. And for that reason, I'll probably end up keeping Manassas. Maybe I'll do a video on that at some time. So that's my review of the Gamers Civil War Brigade series, and thank you for watching.